about that.
Lastly, participatory budgeting is something that is, we've been working on. We have been speaking with a number of folks who are tied to the political process at the city and some other folks, and we believe that we should be able to work with whoever becomes the next city council member to try to bring participatory budgeting to Harlem, work in conjunction with the community board and the community to implement that. So that's something that we're excited about, we are actively working on. So with that, that ends my report. And I would like to ask Andrew, if he's on the phone, to come give the district manager's report.
Good evening. I was actually talking to Terrence. So, a few things. I'll be quick also because I see we went over a little bit on the agenda. So one, I want to start off by saying thank you to Deborah Gilliard, because she was a huge help with our district service cabinet meet and greet, which we had in January. So thank you, Deborah Gilliard, for that. It's like the secret weapon we all use for everything. And thanks to the board members that came out. I know Raquel came out, Troy came out. Brian came and spoke, so definitely, Brian, thank you for coming. So Terrence, he's actually getting something, but we wanted him to speak. But I'll just say kind of things he's been doing. He's been working on our constituent services mainly. He also has other tasks, but the constituent service is his main focus. So this month we got about 22 complaints, and out of that 22 complaints, he's already resolved 15. So most of the complaints are sanitation concerns, and then the rest are other quality of life issues. And Stanley's shaking his head because some of those complaints came from Stanley, right? But then the sanitation concerns led to rodent concerns also. So that's also another issue that we're addressing. That's the two most highest complaints, sanitation and rodents. And it's winter, so once the warm weather kicks in, we assume that's gonna go even higher. So what's good about having Terrence on board and having him focus on the complaints, we've been able to let the community know that we're more available than previously. Now that we have more staff, we have further reach into the community. So even the people who've been having their complaints resolved, they've been reaching out to other people in the neighborhood and tell them to reach out to us. So we'll get referrals. Oh, we heard you solved their complaint, so we have this complaint, we can address that. So that's good news, because now we see we're putting a dent in the complaints and also getting a lot of good response from the community. Another thing I wanted to just say, in December, we had an award ceremony, and at that award ceremony, I didn't get a chance to give a full thank you to the whole board. But I wanted to take just a moment just to say thank you to the board. At that award ceremony, through Deneen and through Crystal and, of course, Brian, they awarded me for the work on Community Board 10. I wasn't expecting it, so I was, like, super shy and was turning red. But I really wanted to say thank you to everybody, because, really, I don't feel like I deserve awards. I just feel like I try to do my job, but really, everyone here is the one who deserves that kind of award. Working with everyone here has been fantastic. Working with Brian, I do have to say, it's been like amazing. So thank you, Brian, for all the kind of toolage you've been giving me. And also, I definitely want to say a special thank you to Deneen. Where's Deneen at? Yes, Deneen Oli back there. I can't say enough about how amazing Deneen's been and all the help she's been giving me. So I really am grateful to have all of you as board members. I'm really grateful to work with everybody here. Thank you. I really am looking forward to working alongside you further. So thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Andrew. He just actually reminded me of one more point. There are a number of block associations and folks who want to form block associations who are asking for legal assistance with that process. I know, Karen, you run a block association. And that's something that we're going to try to facilitate, because as the community changes, sometimes there are different people representing that they run a block and they don't run the block, and it gets very confusing sometimes for us. And so what we're going to try to do is work with some legal representation to help make sure that a number of our blocks have actual functioning block associations, so it will facilitate our work, but also could produce some of the issues that go on. So if you're on a block that does not have a block association, and you want to form one, be part of one, please let us know, because we're going to be focusing on some of that work very shortly. That's a great point. The purpose of the workshop is not to form the block association, it's to provide a framework of what you need to do within your block to form one. But I hear your point. Of course. Absolutely, that's a great point. All right, next, we have, there was a mention that, we are working on the 197A plan at Community Board 10.
You mean the deacon is?
Charles Powell and Raquel Vasquez.
The deacon's working on it.
Are leading that effort.
He ain't never been working on it.
Raquel, you going to get an update on that? Or both of you?
How you doing, baby?
We both come up. Okay. The good
okay, Deacon. We know you the one that's working on it.
Thank you.
Working on what?
197A. Not the so-called leadership. Let's make it clear.
Hi, good evening, everybody. How's everybody doing?
That's right.
Good? All right. As Brad mentioned, both myself and Charles are working. We're both co-chairs of the 197 Task Force. We're on the break, we'll see with Kevin Bitterman, with Downey, and Manny Rivera. And we've just been in conversations over the last several months on how to formulate the plan and how to build the process out using the resources that we have here, the knowledge we have in the room, so working with the committees and then with business associations, with community organizations, and moving forward appropriately with it. So we had a conversation about it, and we're going to be conducting throughout the month of February outreach to each of the committees. So all four of us, so excluding Manny, all four of us would be attending the committee meetings, discussing 197A, helping everyone identify the main issues that the committees want to prioritize. So you'll be seeing us and hearing from us. And yeah, basically the 197A plan, you guys do have a one-pager, but it's essentially a plan where we sign it with DCP, the Department of City Planning, and we also work with the whole gamut of city agencies that would apply to the type of work that we're proposing. So once we get forward with moving with the process, we solidify a process, and we work with the community committees, we'll engage the committee.
I was gonna say, Community Board 9 did one and it got approved. So I would reach out to them to see what they did.
Okay, so we'll be planning a community engagement session so that members of the community would be able to have some input and in, have your jargon input in how this looks. You want to say anything else?
So on the issue of community outreach, we want to do two things. So we're inviting all of you to look at the schedules and come to the committee meetings. And as you know, they're open to the public and participate on that level. And then we'll have those specialized visioning sessions, particular ones for the community at large and community organizations in particular. So we're going to do a lot of outreach because we need your information. A 197A plan is no better than you and your input. So it cannot be a group of us up here trying to intellectualize on this. This has to be the heartbeat and the future of the Harlem community. In a real sense, in a practical sense, in a real sense. So come to the committee meeting. So as Raquel was saying, we're asking all the committee chairs to put this on the agenda of your respective February committee meeting. We'll be there to speak about it, but also to keep it on your agenda as much as we can as we move forward. Because this is going to be a 2 to 3 year process from beginning to end, okay? So, and you'll just, every month, I'm going to suggest to the chair, every meeting of this particular, you know, community board, that we have an update on 197A as a permanent item to be on our regular monthly agenda.
Thank
So I have two other announcements updates for everyone. So again, my name is Raquel Vasquez. I'm chair of the Transportation, Historic Preservation and Landmarks Committee. So I have two updates from the committee. This Friday, we're inviting the community to participate in a walkthrough of West 116th Street. It's a DOT and the mayor's office identified it as a Vision Zero corridor. So 116th Street from Lenox to Madison. So we're working in conjunction on this with CB11 and then with DOT. So I invite everybody to come with us on Friday, 4 p.m. We're meeting in front of CBS on 116th Street in Lenox Avenue.
Today?
What was it?
This Friday?
This Friday, the 3rd. So if you have any questions about that, please feel free to stop over to me, and I'll give you more information or provide any updates, any questions. The second item is that on February 13th, on Monday, February 13th, our committee is meeting, and we're going to have several historic preservation advocates, landmarks preservationists there. We invited MMPCIA, we invited Save Harlem Now, we also invited the Municipal Art Society and the Historic Districts Council. So what we want to see is we want to conduct more community outreach to preserve the landmarks that we have that are not designated by the Landmarks Preservation Commission, and identify them and prioritize them, working with all of you guys and these organizations. So I invite you to come to that committee meeting. It's 6:30 p.m. on Monday, February 13th. And next month, we'll have the Landmarks Preservation Commission come to our meeting. So it would be really valuable for folks to come and make the agency accountable for the landmarks that should be designated and find out how to expedite them. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Raquel. Don't go too far. One quick social point. Arian Putner, she just got her master's in social work, so please give her a round of applause for that. Congratulations.
Thank you for the report, Housing Committee.
Raquel, we're gonna go to your two resolutions first, and then we're gonna do the wine and beer license last. Okay.
Okay. So tonight, I'll be presenting two resolutions for street co-namings, one for Ruby D and one for Ozzie Davis. Our committee approved unanimously in support of the street co-namings. They would be located on West 123rd Street and St. Nicholas Avenue. So one resolution would be for Ozzie Davis Way, and the second resolution is for Ruby D Place. So I'll start off with Ruby D Place's street co-naming. Resolution to support co-naming of corner of West 123rd Street and St. Nicholas Avenue facing east in front of 258 St. Nicholas Avenue to Ruby D Place. Whereas Ruby D was a distinguished citizen, actress, civil rights leader, and humanitarian, and Ruby D was born in Ohio on October 27, 1922, and grew up in Harlem, New York. And whereas Ms. D enjoyed a tremendous career on the stage, on television, and in film, and joined the American Negro Theater in 1941, is well known for her collaborations and with her late husband, Ozzie Davis. And whereas D had her first major career breakthrough in 1946, when she took the title role of A&T's Broadway production of Anna Lucasta. That same year, she met actor Ozzie Davis while performing in the play Jug. The couple married 2 years later and eventually had three children together. And whereas D landed a starring role on Broadway in Lorraine Hansberry's play, A Raisin in the Sun, 1959, great play. She earned great acclaim for her portrayal of Ruth Younger in this drama about a struggling African-American family, and whereas Ruby, alongside her husband, Ozzie, were also very active in the civil rights movement, participating in marches and speaking out for racial equality. Both Dee and Davis were friends of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King Jr., and whereas Ruby Dee won a multitude of awards and honors, including an Emmy Award in 1991, Screen Actors Guild Award in 2001, and an NAACP Chairman's Award in 2008. And whereas on June 11, 2014, Dee died at her home in New Rochelle in New York at the age of 91. Whereas Ms. Dee impacted generations of humanitarians, actors, artists, and activists, and is supported by the State Assembly member Keith Wright and former U.S. Congress member Charles Rangel. So that's one resolution. Ozzie Davis Way Street Co-Naming Resolution. This resolution is to support the co-naming at the corner of West 123rd Street and St. Nicholas Avenue, facing north in front of 258 St. Nicholas Avenue to Ozzie Davis Way. Whereas Ozzie Davis was a distinguished citizen, actor, civil rights leader, and humanitarian, and whereas Ozzie Davis was born as Ray Ford Chapman Davis in Cogdale, Georgia on December 18, 1917, and whereas Mr. Davis enjoyed a tremendous career on the stage, on television, and in film, and is well known for his collaborations with Louis D. And, okay, I'm just gonna skip down. So whereas on February 4th, 2005, Ozzie Davis passed away in Miami, Florida, and whereas Mr. Davis impacted generations of humanitarians, actors, artists, and activists, and is supported by State Assembly member Keith Wright and U.S. Congress member Charles Rangel. So those are the two street co-names that we'll vote on. So the organization, the Dwyer Cultural Association, is located close by on that block, and they named the theater along with their family members of Ruby Davis. Both of them, their family members, supported the renaming of the theater inside of the cultural center. So they're well aware of the street coding for the block in honor of that naming as well.
Can you clarify, is it one corner, two signs pointing different ways?
Two corners, two signs.
Okay, so one corner is on the northeast side.
Yes.
Of St. Nicholas Avenue. And the other corner is on?
Facing north.
Facing
west.
Northwest.
So they're on opposite ends.
They're on opposite. Okay. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Okay. One more item. I'm sure everyone notices that we have one more item. Before John comes up to talk about this, the Wine of Your Life, Amy Ruth, I asked Marquise just to come say a couple of words, some ground rules, really quickly. That we're going to follow, that we're going to ask John to follow, and that if need be, I will help make sure that you follow, just so that there's some order. And then afterwards, John will present the voting item.
My signature, sir.
John will present the beer and liquor license, and I guess the business will then respond. But this is because last month we had a lot of debate. So we would like to limit, if the board is okay with that, to starting it with 20 minutes. Right? That's the board questions,
and discussion from the community. At that time, if we need to extend, then the board would do so. But we're asking that we have put a limit now so that we can kind of have some type of order. Additionally, is that we would act, you know, John is going to have the discretion to call on individuals. There were people, individuals who spoke during the public announcements about this and fully outlined. It is not a debate in which you say someone else gets up and let me counter that. So we all have an opportunity, you have an opportunity to speak and give your opinion. If you've done so, we ask that you respect and allow others to then speak, and so that we're not constantly getting back up to debate each other. And at the end of the day, the board will still have to make their own decision. Board members will have to make their own decision. Okay?
Will those of us who were expecting to speak earlier be given an opportunity to speak?
So did you sign up, sir?
Yes.
Yeah, then you should okay. Absolutely. Yeah. Right. Could,
thank
yeah,
you.
Okay, Marquise. So again, this is the renewal of the wine and beer license for Amy Ruth's restaurant, 113 West 116th Street. That's between Lennox Malcolm X and Adam Clayton Powell Jr. Boulevard on the north side. Just the procedure at the Economic Development Committee, the applicant presented, and the board actually, there were two votes at the Economic Development Committee. The motion to support the application had a vote of 4 in favor, 1 against, and 3 abstentions. A second motion was made in light of the discussion that we had last month on the topic. A motion was made to bring the matter to the full board, which again is quite unusual. We typically never bring renewal applications here. But the feeling of the Economic Development Committee was that that should be done here. So I'm sure most people are aware of Amy Ruth, so I'm just going to, we've heard some discussion of this already, so I'm just going to invite the applicants up, the owners of Amy Ruth, to come up, and I know they want to address the board. And the community, thank you, Dan.
I came into Harlem in 1971 at the height of racism in Harlem, United States. I was 21 years old. I did not come from a privileged background. My father was an egg farmer, and I bought my first supermarket on 116th Street. I went through the race riots. I was here when the lights went out. I was a true minority. I faced a lot of obstacles. I had 2 guns to my head at 2 different holdups, but I continued to move forward. I brought many businesses and continued to invest in the Harlem community. I made many friends here. I've been here for 45 years. I own this restaurant for 7 years. In 45 years, I have an unblemished record. We've never had one infraction in regard to the restaurant. Absolutely none. I've always had a very good relationship with the Muslim community. I know Tariq for many, many years. Always respected you. You came to me, we were both young, and you were representing the Shabazz products. And I embraced the Muslim community. I took your products into one of my stores and promoted them. The mosque came to me with a gentleman by the name of Albert, with Tariq. I had owned the property next to the mosque, which I did not want to sell. I am not a seller. I've always believed in buying property in Harlem. They came to me. I absolutely did not want to sell, but Albert said, Mitchell, we need this property for our mosque. I sold you the property. Not that I wanted to, but I felt that that was the right thing to do. That was the just thing to do. And I did it. This is an iconic restaurant. We attract people from all over the world. It's a family style restaurant. We don't encourage drinking. We serve, if you know our core menu, it's chicken and waffles. And in my restaurant, I have a picture on the wall. I have a picture on the wall of ex-President Obama, Martin Luther King, and Malcolm X.
What about
that's from Carl, John.
Yes, I do.
That's a good thing to have.
That's not from Carl. I'm the one who implemented that about 3-4 years ago. I bought this restaurant out of bankruptcy. Even though I own the real estate, I had to buy this out of bankruptcy. Mm-hmm. So anybody can guesstimate on the profitability. I don't know this young lady at all, but she, you know, she made a point that alcohol is an integral part of the success in a restaurant. We work on a very, very small margin. We run a volume operation. We give a tremendous value to the community. Everybody walks out of there with a large package before they leave. And in all due respect to the Muslim community, and I respect their beliefs, and they have a right to practice their religion any way they want. If they don't want to drink or they don't believe in drinking, that's fine. And I respect that. I don't judge anybody by what they do. This is America. But 99% of the people that come to my restaurant are not Muslim, and they want to have a beer or a glass of wine with their meal. We do not serve hard alcohol. I've been there for 7 years without one infraction of a perfect record. I don't know if there are too many restaurants in New York that can make that claim. And I want to continue to have a good relationship with the Muslim community, because I think that anybody that's met me knows that I'm a very fair and balanced guy. I live and let live, and everybody is entitled to do what they want as long as it doesn't impose or impact somebody else. And I just feel that it's very important that we maintain that. I just hope that you give me the fair consideration, because I think I've always tried to do that in the community. 45 years I've been here. I took over Jagerman's Supermarket next to the post office in 1971. There's not too many people that could say that they, especially Caucasian, that has the track record and has done the things for the community that I have done. When I took over when I bought this building on 116th Street at the corner, Harlem World was in there. It was
Harlem
a nightclub.
World. Mm-hmm.
I cleaned it up. Right now there's a school for the very severely challenged children. I leased some space to the Senegalese consulate, Muslim community. I've had many Muslim tenants. To me, it's never made any difference. Muslim, Palestinian, Jew, Christian, we're Americans. And I just hope that you give me the same consideration that I have always given the community. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, first we're gonna start with questions from the board. Stanley?
Waiting on the renewal, but generally speaking, the renewal is
intently go through and unless somebody can prove otherwise. So we can just address those two issues.
Sure. If the board votes today not to support the application, we would advise the SLA of that fact, and we would advise them on the vote.
Well, can you take that further? When we advise the SLA, can you explain that as well? What the outcome is generally, or a lot of times?
Well, I mean, 99% of the time we vote to support applications. When there's a 500 foot here, the SLA requests the resolution from us. But here again, we are an advisory board, so we don't have final say. The SLA will presumably take what we tell them into consideration when they determine whether they would renew the application or not. Does that answer the question?
Yeah.
Thank you, Julius. Stanley, does that answer your question?
yes and no. I just want to know how much weight, and that's what I'm saying. How much weight?
I honestly don't know. I mean, I deal with the SLA a lot, but again, we're not typically going to them and saying, we don't want this license, we don't want you to renew this. That will be a new... we're going to vote on whether to support or not support the application. Yes? Sure, Lisa. I'll try to do that. The committee member who made the motion actually is not here, so I can try to address what I think that she was saying. But as I suggested, I think the person who made the motion was concerned about consistency in our consideration and voting on these types of applications in light of the vote that we had last month on another establishment just a block away. A brand new establishment, yes. Are there any other questions from the... Yes, Crystal.
How many times have they had their wine and beer? I mean, the
three times, I believe, and then they're 7 years. Every 2 years.
Three.
Okay. Yes, Andrea.